Hey guys, I'm Matt from MWA Woodworks, and in this video, I'm going to upgrade this cluttered, disorganized pantry space and turn it into this. Much taller, deeper, and a lot more organized. Stay tuned, and I'll show you how I did it.
So this project is just the beginning of what's going to be a multi-step process in updating the pantry in my house. I plan on adding more cabinets and counter space later, but my wife and I decided that we really needed to tackle food storage first. The storage we have now is just some basic wooden shelving that's not super deep. It tends to get cluttered pretty easily and items get mixed together because there's nothing separating them. The worst part though is that the larger items tend to stack up on the floor in front and limit your ability to walk around and grab stuff off the shelves. So from that we learned that we definitely wanted deeper cabinets, and the ones that I'm going to be making now are going to be 18 inches deep. We also want a better way to separate and keep track of all the different items that we store here, canned goods, snack foods, pasta, etc. To solve that, I'm going to be adding 10 pull-out drawers to the lower half of these cabinets, and the upper half is just going to be open shelving for larger items like paper towels and bulk buys. I'm also making these cabinets tall. I'm going to go ahead and use the full length of the 8-foot sheets of plywood here. I've got 9-foot ceilings in our home, so they're going to easily fit inside the pantry, and better use that wall space that wasn't being used before. Now, after breaking down the plywood, I go ahead and cut the sides to final width. Basically, I'm just cutting off the factory edge here to give nice, clean, sharp edges. As I mentioned before, I'm making these 8 feet high, so I don't need to cut these sides to length. Next, I need to go ahead and cut the top, bottom dividers and the shelves for each of the cabinets, and I'm doing this with my track saw at the MFT. It's also really nice to use a rolling support here to help support the long plywood strips as I cut them down. And guys, that's it. All the cabinet parts are cut and ready for joinery. For joinery, I'm using dados, and to cut those, I'm using an undersized plywood bit. This is a special router bit that matches the width of plywood, since a sheet of 3/4 inch plywood isn't really 3/4 inch. I begin by cutting rabbets in each end of the sides to hold the top and the bottom. This is pretty easy to do at the router table in my table saw because I get to use the entire width of the table saw for support. Now you can also do this job with a handheld router and a straight edge. For me personally, I always try to use the router table for any operation that I can because I find this way to be safer and I can more easily be accurate with my cut. Now the last thing I need to do is make this dado down the middle to hold the divider between the drawer section of the cabinets and the shelf section on top. I also sanded the edges of the parts that are going to go into these dados to remove some of that finish and allow them to be glued together more easily. And now it's time for assembly. I just add glue to the dados and add the center divider first. Now I'm also going to countersink and screw these together for two reasons. The practical reason is that the screws were going to act like clamps while the glue dries, and this means that I don't have to use clamps and wait around for those glue joints to dry on their own. I can just keep assembling. And the other reason is that because of how these cabinets are going to be installed, these sides are never going to be seen, so I don't have to worry about having ugly screw holes in the final piece. I'm also adding some right angle clamps here to keep everything nice and square while I assemble, and then move on to adding the top and the bottom. These are done in the exact same way as the center divider. Just add some glue and then screw in from the sides. And then I'm just going to set this first cabinet aside to dry while I tackle the second cabinet. And you can see here how nice and tall these are going to be. Now the second cabinet goes exactly the way the first one did. I did end up using one clamp because this pesky center dado was a bit tight and I had to drive it home with a little persuasion. Alright, so later on in the day, after the glue had time to dry, I went ahead and added my shelf pin holes to the top half of the cabinets. I really could have done this before assembly, but doing it now with the cabinets still open in the back is just as easy. And I really like using this little Craig shelf pin jig for this job. It has an indexing pin that allows you to make a set of holes and then line yourself up with that pin to extend that set of holes down as far as you need to go. Now to finish off assembly, I just need to add the backs. I'm using 1/2 inch plywood to make these nice and strong. And I'm just screwing these down from the back side. This is just the easiest way to do it because the edges of these plywoods are not going to be seen. And this way I'm maximizing the space inside the cabinet versus, say, insetting the back into a rabbet or a groove on the back. I really just wanted these to be quick and easy to assemble so I could get them out of the way and focus on all the drawers I need to make. But before I get to those drawers, there was one small detail that I needed to take care of, and that is adding edge banding to the front edge of my shelves. I only need to do the front edge because the other edges are never going to be seen. Now for this job, I'm going to be using iron-on edge banding, and that's really simple to apply, and I only have 4 total shelves, so this went by pretty fast. I just ironed it on, and then I used this little roller to make sure that it was firmly attached. I can then trim the ends and use this fancy double-edged trimmer to remove the excess on the sides. Okay, now with the cabinet carcasses all done, I'm moving on to the drawers. Now my favorite drawer material is always hard maple. It has a nice clean look no matter whether you're pairing it with hardwood or a painted surface, and it's super durable. I begin by chopping everything down to rough length at the miter saw. Chopping and chopping and chopping and chopping. 40 total drawer sides. Yikes! Now after all my parts were cut, I flattened one side of each one at the joiner, and then I squared up one edge to that flat side. After that, I could just run everything through the planer until I reached a thickness of 5/8 of an inch for the two sides and the back, and 3/4 of an inch for the drawer fronts. I could then go back to the table saw and cut each part to final width. And I'm making the drawer sides 4 inches high and the drawer fronts 6 inches high. Finally, I cut all the parts to final length using my miter gauge. Now I want to show you 2 different ways to construct the type of drawers that I'm building for these cabinets. The first way is to use what's called a locking rabbet joint, and this method can be done entirely using the table saw and nothing else. I first need to cut a groove into all the sides like this. I'm using a table saw blade with flat teeth so that the bottom of the groove is flat and clean. Then in the drawer fronts, I need to make a series of cuts that will start with making a vertical cut. Then I make a horizontal cut to create a little tongue. And the whole thing fits together like this. Pretty easy and also satisfying when it all fits together nicely. Now you might ask about the top of that where the joint's sticking up above the sides, but I'm going to tell you how I'm taking care of that here in just a minute. The last thing I need to do here is to cut grooves in all the parts to accept the drawer bottoms. You can see here how the 1/4-inch plywood fits really nicely into that groove. You don't want this groove to be super tight, but you also don't want it to be really loose so that the drawer bottom rattles all over the place. Now for the back of the drawers, I'm using pocket screws, and I'm going to explain exactly why I chose this route in a minute. I promise I have a plan. Hey guys, I would just like to take a minute to say thank you for watching this video, and if you find a lot of value in it, I would certainly appreciate it if you subscribe to my channel. Also, make sure to hit that bell icon to be notified every time I release new content. Me being able to continue to make videos like this depends entirely on your support. Also, if you see me using something in this video and you'd like to check it out for yourself, always make sure to check the description below because that's where I leave links to the products that I use in my videos. Thank you once again, guys. Now let's continue on with the build. Now the second method I'm going to show you for attaching these drawer fronts is with dominoes. Now you can sub in dowels here if you don't own a domino, but I'm going to use a domino. I need to plunge into the sides to make my mortises, and I'm using this awesome domino dock that my friend Ramon Valdez makes. It cradles the domino perfectly and makes this process super easy. Now, Ramon sells these little domino docks, and I'm going to go ahead and leave a link in the description below if you want one for your shop. And for the fronts, I need to mortise into the face of the board instead of the end, so my vise helps out with this job. Now, you'll notice I'm using a second drawer front as a backer board to add more surface to balance the domino on. And I just extend my reference lines to the sides and make the cuts. The drawer bottoms are going to be made out of 1/4-inch ply, and this is pretty easy to cut up at the table saw. After ripping it down, I can just cut it up into finished dimensions. And after all that chopping, milling, joinery, and cutting at the table saw, I've got a whopping 50 drawer parts. For the drawer fronts, I wanted to do something a little different. I wanted to add a pull to the top edge. These drawers won't have false fronts, and I'm not going to be putting any hardware on them, so this is going to be a great solution. You can see here that I made this template from plywood, and I'm just going to stick it to the drawer front using two-sided tape. I go ahead and remove most of the waste at the bandsaw, and you can also use a jigsaw for this if you don't have a bandsaw. Now I'm using the template as a guide here, but I'm staying about an eighth of an inch away from it so I don't accidentally cut into it. Now once the bulk of the waste is removed, I use a flush trim bit at the router to run it against the template and make everything nice and clean. So the first step in assembling these drawers is going to be to glue the two sides to the front. Just glue and clamps and we're good. The locking rabbit version goes together exactly the same way, just glue and clamps. Now after sanding all the drawer assemblies, I finish them with General Finishes High Performance. This is a water-based top coat that protects the wood, but it doesn't add any color at all. If you look here, the drawers on the left are unfinished, and the drawers on the right have been sprayed already. Other than a little more grain definition, the finished drawers don't look much different in terms of color than the raw wood. Oh, and if you don't have a sprayer, you can apply this finish with a foam brush just like I'm doing here. Once the drawer parts are finished, I install the drawer bottoms and then screw on the back with pocket screws. I chose to do it this way with the pocket screws because the drawer bottoms were already pre-finished and I didn't need to spray those. Once the drawers were all assembled, I could then add the drawer slides. Now I like lining up my drawer slides with the bottom of the drawers and that allows me to install them using this method. I just set the drawer slide against the drawer bottom on a flat surface and extend the slide out so that you can see where to screw the drawers into place. Easy peasy. The last thing I need to do is make the face frame and the trim for these cabinets. Again, I'm going to use hard maple for this and I just rip these boards into strips and plane everything down to final thickness. For the face frames, I'm using dominoes again. A lot of people use pocket screws for the face frames, and that's a great way to do it since those are never going to be seen. But assembling with dominoes couldn't be easier. Just glue and clamp everything up. The only downside here is that you have to let it dry before you can do anything else with it. Now for the only side of the cabinet that's going to be visible in this installation, I'm going to do a 4-inch railing style trim. Now since this is just decorative and is going to be screwed to the side of the cabinets, I'm just going to go ahead and skip the dominoes altogether and just glue it. It doesn't really need a lot of strength here, so this is not going to make a difference. Now once the trim was out of the clamps, I just broke the edges a tiny bit by using a chamfer bit and my palm router. Now I'm talking like a 64th of an inch here, not much at all, just enough to make sure that the edges aren't sharp. After that, I just screwed the trim to the side of the cabinet from the inside. Now since I'm painting these cabinets, I just went ahead and added a little wood filler over the screw holes that I can go back and sand later before I paint. This is going to make these screw holes invisible in the final piece. I also made sure the trim was perfectly flush with the sides of the cabinets by using a flush trim bit on that as well. Now one other thing I needed to do before installation was make a little base for the cabinets out of 2x4s. I milled them down to size and I assembled them with pocket screws. The cabinets are going to sit on top of this base and I'll nail the base trim to these sides. Now for the cabinets, I'm going to go ahead and spray them with a shellac base primer and then use Sherwin-Williams ChemAqua Plus for the top coat. This finish dries fast and is really hard and durable and it's one of my favorite finishes for painted cabinets. Okay, fast forward, and I have the cabinets painted and ready to install. I set the two cabinets onto the base like so, and then position everything perfectly, lining it up at the edges. I then fasten the two cabinets together with screws. Next, I laid the face frame out on the kitchen floor and added glue, waiting until my wife left the house so I didn't earn myself any dirty looks. I just spread the glue, and then I carefully took it into the pantry. I positioned everything and began adding pin nails and clamps. Now these thin strips of face frame were like spaghetti and had warped a little bit. So I added plenty of clamping pressure to help keep everything firmly attached while the glue dried. I then added the center pieces of the face frame with pin nails and glue. Alright, fast forward again and the face frame is all dry and in place and now I can just move these cabinets into final position. I then securely fastened the cabinets to the wall using cabinet screws, making sure to screw into the studs in the wall. I could then begin installing all the drawers, starting from the top. Now my favorite way of doing this is making a spacer out of plywood or MDF to perfectly align the slides on each side. And once I got both top drawers installed, I could take that piece of plywood back to the table saw and cut it down for the next set of drawer slides. I just worked my way down until all 10 drawers were installed. Now you'll see here that I added progressive amounts of space between the drawers as I moved down to allow for larger items to be stored there. Really, you can arrange these drawers with any size gap that you want to fit your own needs. I then just added shelf pin clips and went ahead and added the shelves to the top. And the next day I came back and added the trim to the base. Lastly, I went ahead and added some quarter round to the side where the cabinet's face frame met the wall to hide any gaps. And that's it. Last thing to do is begin filling these cabinets. Well, hey guys, I really hope you enjoyed this video, and most importantly, I hope you learned something from it. Now, if you did, I would certainly appreciate that thumbs up, and also leave me a comment below to let me know what you thought.